Swell Season Surf Radio is recorded by the Newsstand Studio at Rockefeller Center in the heart of Manhattan and is distributed by Wax.Radio. Hello and welcome to Swell Season Surf Radio. I am your host, Tyler Brewer. Bonnie Tsui was born in Queens, New York, and raised on Long Island. She has been a competitive swimmer, rower, climber, snowboarder, surfer. Oh, and just happened to graduate from Harvard University magna cum laude in English and American Literature and Language. No big deal. She is the author of multiple books and has won numerous awards and accolades. One of her more recent books, Why We Swim, celebrates the role water has played throughout history and across the globe. It covers everything from Olympic champions, a Baghdad swim club that meets in Saddam Hussein's former palatial pool, modern-day Japanese samurai swimmers, and even an Icelandic fisherman who somehow survives a wintry 6-hour swim after a shipwreck and becomes a national hero. And if that weren't enough, Sarah and the Big Wave, the true story of the first woman to surf Mavericks, is a new children's book written by Bonnie and beautifully illustrated by Sophie Dow. It tells the story of legendary Sarah Gerhard and her journey to becoming one of the first female surfers at Mavericks. I've been a huge fan of Sarah's for a while, and this is an awesome book. For any parent whose child is into surfing, I highly recommend it. It comes with a complete history of women surfing. It's explaining how big waves are formed. It's the perfect last-minute gift for the holidays, so everyone go check it out. And Bonnie is also a contributor to the New York Times, and I'm super excited because Bonnie is our guest on this episode of Swell Season Surf Radio. Bonnie, welcome to the show.
Tyler, I'm so happy to be here. Thank you for that very, very nice introduction.
Thank you.
And it means a lot, especially because we go so far back together.
I know.
It's so fun to see your face.
Do you want to explain to our listeners how far back that goes?
Yeah, I would say, let's see, 22 years or so, 21 years, something like that.
22 years.
Tyler and I worked at a now defunct adventure travel magazine called Blue, and it was the coolest. It was so fun. We had offices in Soho and in this like big loft space, and it was less like we lived the dream for a hot second.
Yeah.
In the aughts, and that was cool.
It was like, to me, like kind of peak New York in some ways.
Oh, like, so peak New York, yeah.
Like total, because you still had a little bit of the edge, a little bit of the rawness in mm-hmm. parts of the city mm-hmm. where you could have warehouse parties and you could still afford to live there. But at the same time, it was clean and safe enough to walk around for the most part and take the subway. And like Soho was such a hub then where we worked, which was freaking awesome. Like, but it was still like you could go to the taxi cab place and get really good Indian food, you know? It was like such a cool little area.
I just remember, yeah. And then also that, like, that was when adventure travel and adventure sports were new and cool and just hitting the mainstream. And, you know, I remember working at that magazine and then starting to freelance where I would write some stories for the New York Times. And it was like such a like a niche thing. Like,
yeah.
Ooh, like what's adventure? What's adventurous? What is adventure travel? What's like, you know? And it's like, well, it's just traveling. It's just doing some sports maybe, or like physical activities when you're out there.
And, well, to me, it felt like, you know, we were, it was the opposite of tourist travel. Like, you know, I there's a difference. I always thought there was a difference between a tourist and a traveler. You know, like a tourist goes on a trip and they remain unchanged, but a traveler goes on a trip and they come back with new set of eyes almost.
Right.
You know, and that's how I always viewed it through that perspective, I think.
For sure. Yeah. And I think that we were such wide-eyed, you know, young travelers and writers at that stage as well. So we were coming at it with that awe and with that wonder, which I think is just... that's where you want to be when you go to a new place, and to not be the jaded, you know, old folks we are now. Well, I mean, look at us.
Oh, you know, I mean, I got salt and pepper beard and like grizzled, and you know, it's also like there wasn't as much of a travel infrastructure, I feel like, that there is
that's
now.
Right. I think that's like, right. Yeah.
Like you can go Airbnb anywhere. Mm-hmm. And back then you had a Lonely Planet guidebook, and you had your backpack and a bunch of youth hostels, and that was it, you know?
And then your connection was going to an actual internet cafe.
Yes. Yes.
Remember those?
Oh my gosh.
I'm going to write an email on Hotmail to my mother at home. Anyway, well, all joking aside, it was like a really fun and wondrous time, and that was when Tyler and I first got to know each other, and it's been a long time.
Yeah, it's been a while, and like you've gone on to some amazing things, and you know, so one thing, like reading this book, like, you know, one of the things, like reading Why We Swim, you go into a little bit of your history and your backstory. Mm-hmm. One thing I didn't realize when I worked with you is how much of a competitive swimmer you were, because I was too. I was captain of my high school swim team, which we went undefeated in Suffolk County.
Wow.
In 97. So, and you were too. You were quite the competitive swimmer. I mean, so much so that your hair was like chlorinated, you know? And
that was my default scent, as I'm sure it was for you as well. I mean, it was such a formative time and such a particular way of growing up, right? To have, I mean, to do team sports, but I think particularly for me, for swimming, swimming occupied a place in my life that was, it was a community outside of school and outside of a more like, you know, homogenized experience of the world that I had when I was growing up on Long Island. And so the swim team was like super diverse, drew from many different pockets of Long Island. And so people, you know, it was a club team, and it was like scrappy, and it was, you know, and it was like in a town that was, you know, heavily Black and Latino. And so there were all different bodies in the water, and that was something that meant a lot to me when my sort of daily life was like pretty white, and then also on my weekend life was very Chinese, you know, like visiting my family in Chinatown and Flushing, and so that was like this bifurcated existence that I had, that I didn't realize that, you know, neither one felt just like me until I joined the swim team, and then it was like, oh, like, you know, I could be here and known, my family, my brother, my cousins on this team, we were known as like not the Chinese kids. We were known as like the breaststrokers, you know, like I loved it, you know, and it was so fun to be seen for something other than what I had been sort of like accustomed to being categorized as at school, you know, in certain ways. And, you know, and to be like, I credit being on the swim team with my comfort in my body and as a woman and, you know, as a girl growing up. I mean, I just remember like all the kids I grew up with, like my friends who were girls, they, you know, we'd have a I'd go over to a friend's house for a pool party. All the girls would be wearing t-shirts over their swimsuits in the pool, and all the guys would be, you know, just like in their trunks, like cannonballing, whatever. And I would just, and I would be the only one who would be wearing my like my speedo. My like racing suit. Like, what's up, guys? Like, functional. You know, wear your swimsuit and swim.
Where's your speedo? Where's your cap? Where's your goggles?
Yeah, where's your come cap? On. Your goggles? Like, come on, get your, what, you know, this is my practice suit. I have my drag suit on.
I was just gonna say, did you have a drag suit on? Because like that's what I always totally. Had too. Like.
Yeah. And you take it off and you're like, I'm the fastest person ever. But you know, like just having that, like understanding that not everyone had, you know, like when you're an adolescent, when you're like a teenager, oh God, like especially like junior high, early high school, just feeling like so uncomfortable in your body. And I never felt that way because of swimming, because I started at such a young age. And everyone's walking around in their swimsuits, like, and it's co-ed. So, like, you get comfortable, like, being in your swimsuit with the opposite sex, and, like, that's cool. And puberty is very exciting, but also, like, it's, you know, you're there for other reasons, too. So, it well, was, you know.
I feel like it's interesting, like, that you say that. Particularly, like, junior high, high school is, like, a time when you're looking to fit in lots of places, right? Yeah. Like you're, mm-hmm. you're looking like you're looking at all these different social cliques, you know, you're the like mm-hmm. your socies, you know, the popular kids, you have the goths, you have punk, you have skaters, you have all these different, you have jocks, you have all these different, you know, groups. And it's interesting.
Is that an outsiders reference that you just made?
Probably. Yeah. You know, threw down.
I was like, whoa.
Stay gold, pony boy. Stay gold.
You know? I had to like dig that out of the back, like the recesses of my brain. Nice. I like that.
But you had these groups and a lot of kids are insecure and looking to fit in. And I feel like swimming provided that for you, gave you a sense of identity mm-hmm. and a place of belonging that for those sure. other groups didn't have to, you know, provide for you. And mm-hmm. I felt like that was surfing, actually, you know, mm-hmm. growing up. Mm-hmm. I was the only surfer in my school. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so I was known as the surfer. But it gave me social mobility, actually, where I didn't have mm-hmm. to belong to one group either. And it mm-hmm. also gave me a sense that, oh, these people don't know. Like, they don't know my life outside of this school.
Yeah.
And the people that I know and all the cool kids that are outside or achieve these other things, you know? And I think, like, mm-hmm. that was a similar experience for you then.
Yeah, the confidence that I hear you, that I hear in your voice when you're talking about that time where you're like, oh, you know, this allows me more of a fluidity because they don't know me. All of me.
Yeah.
And I think that it's like if like to have a choice in that in a time when kids don't feel they have the agency, you know, mm-hmm. and I think that to, you know, in retrospect, those, you know, to make the choice to do something that's outside of what already everyone else is doing and because you love it, like that's so beautiful. And also that it's your chosen tribe, which again, like, you know, there's a limit when you're a kid, there's a limitation to what you can choose to do and where, you know, who can you choose to hang out with and all that. And then I think that's what, you know, again, I really do feel like I was an old soul trapped in a kid's body for so long. And I like once I was sort of set free in the world, it was happy making for me because I could make more of those choices.
You, swimming also played a huge role in like how your parents met, correct? Like mm-hmm. your dad was a lifeguard and he met your mom at the pool. Is that?
Yep. They met in a swimming pool in Hong Kong. Yeah. It's like such our like myth, our family origin story, the mythology of that. Yeah. Like they just totally had the hots for each other. I mean, let's be straight. Like they were beautiful and then, you know, as we, like when we were kids, like we spent a lot of time with them in the water. Like they, you know, we went to Jones Beach together as a family and my father would kind of go out and swim, you know, beyond the shore break. And I just was like, oh my gosh, like I want to go out there one day to do that because it seems so scary. Because he would just go, you know, back and forth and then we'd sort of lose sight of him. But then, you know, and then he'd come back and then we would swim. We, you know, they would sometimes come to practice and swim in the pool next to us when we were practicing. And but it was also, you know, it was like a time, you know, it was a time when that we did spend together as a family, because my parents ultimately divorced, and their marriage was not a